Hi, and welcome back to my channel. This will be my first Sunday session of 2019. And so, as you may or may not know, one of my goals for this year was to be better at tithing. And when I made that goal, I just thought, well, what? I know the common knowledge is, as a Christian, that it's 10% of your income. And so I just thought that it would be interesting if I just went ahead and did some research on the topic, because to be honest, I really didn't know what was required. And just pay attention to that word, required, because I learned a lot about tithing. So if you're interested, just keep watching. Okay, and I'm sorry if I cough. I'm still trying to get over this cold or whatever it is that I had. I had the flu and the pneumonia, but I'm just still going through the process. You know, the cough is the last thing to go. So as I started researching, I realized that a common practice in the Old Testament and requirement of members of the nation of Israel was to tithe. And a tenth part of something paid as a voluntary contribution or as a tax, especially for the support of a religious establishment, was common or required. Members were to give crops they grew and the livestock they raised to the tabernacle or the temple. And you can find that practice in Leviticus chapter 27, verse 30, Numbers chapter 18, verse 26. Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 24, and 2 Chronicles chapter 31, verse 5. The Old Testament required multiple tithes, actually, one for the Levites, one for the use of the temple and the feast, and one for the poor of the land, which would have pushed the total to around 2.3% or 23.3% of all that was required of them, which, like we said, it was a tenth of their income, their livestock, their crops. That it included everything. Some understand the Old Testament tithe as a method of taxation to provide for the needs of the priests and Levites in a sacrificial system. I think the common verse in the Old Testament when they were talking about tithing and how much they should give, they always talked about the verse that said, will a mere mortal rob God? Yet you rob me, but you ask, how am I robbing you? In tithing and offerings, you are under a curse, your whole nation, because you are robbing me. But the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessings that there will not be room enough to store it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and the vines in your fields will not drop their fruit before it's ripe. And we can find this in Malachi chapter 3, verse 8 through 11. And so in the Old Testament, if the nation of Israel did not give what they were supposed to, then they were robbing God, and they were to be cursed, and God would not bless their crops and homes, or not give them the blessing of, you know, it says the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there would not be enough room to store it. So I think that when we think about that, we think about that being applicable to today's times. And so all of that I just read was the Old Testament. So now let's cover what's in the New Testament. The significant teaching on giving is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 2, which says, on the first day of every week, each of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with his income. This passage points out four things. We should give individually, regularly, methodically, and proportionately. The matter of giving is between you and God, and he always takes into account our circumstances. He knows when they are beyond our power to direct or control. The important thing is that we see giving as a privilege and not a burden. It should not be out of a sense of duty, but rather out of love for the Lord and a desire to see his kingdom advance. And so we kind of see the different, of course, that last part is just a overall interpretation of the scripture, which means there is not an amount set, and it doesn't mention a requirement. So after the death of Jesus Christ, he fulfilled the law. The New Testament nowhere commands or even recommends that the Christian submit to a logistic tithe system. The New Testament nowhere designates a percentage of income a person should set aside, but only says gifts should be in keeping with income. Again, referencing 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 2. Some in the Christian church have taken the 10% figure from the Old Testament tithe and applied it as the recommended minimum for Christians in their giving. The New Testament talks about the importance and benefits of giving. We are to give as we are able. Sometimes that means giving more than 10%. Sometimes that means giving less. It all depends on the ability of the Christian and the needs of the church. Every Christian should diligently pray and seek God's wisdom in the matter of participating in tithing and or how much to give. And you should read James chapter 1, verse 5. Above all, the tithes and offerings should be given with pure motives and an attitude of worship to God and serve the body of Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 through 7 says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And so that's kind of relative to what they were saying in the Old Testament and in Malachi, where he says he will throw open the floodgates of blessings. And then in 2 Corinthians, you know, whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. So it's kind of, you know, hinting at the same thing, that, you know, God will give back to us what we sow. So kind of it's that reap and sowing type of aspect or viewpoint. The tithe should be given to God faithfully. Tithing honors the scriptural principles of generously providing for the church, giving to those in need, and laying up treasures in heaven. Throughout scripture, we are encouraged to give the first part of our resources to God as an expression of honor and gratitude. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 through 10 states, honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of all thy increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. And again, it's just the same thing is that, you know, when we give to honor God, God will then bless us in return. So the other thing that kind of came to my mind was when I was thinking about how to tithe and how much to tithe, and you know, maybe this is not as common for you, but for me, I thought, well, are we supposed to tithe from our gross income, or are we supposed to tithe from our net income? And I think that's a fair question, because we don't really know, if we get a bonus, if we, I don't know, any type of income that comes into the home, we should also think about giving to God. And so anyway, in evaluating the scriptures, I didn't find where it referred to gross or net income. And the only thing that I could think about when I thought about net or gross income, and some people might think, oh, that's a far-fetched thought. This is just my thought. And in researching this, and this is just kind of the revelation that I had, and it may not be relevant at all, but I recall Jesus telling, I believe in John chapter 18, verse 36. And they were talking about when Jesus was here on earth, and he said to one of the disciples that to give Caesar what belonged to Caesar. And to me, when we think about our income and our gross income, we do have to give our Social Security or Medicare and everything we have to give beforehand. And then the rest is ours, our net income. And so when I think about, first fruits, I think about net income. And again, I don't want to nickel and dime this. I do not, that's not the intention of my video. What I'm trying to do is just kind of talk to you about what I have come across in studying this, because this is one of my goals, is to tie better. And I thought, well, I need to have a good understanding of, what does God want me to do, but what also kind of came to me is, in addition to tithing, we should give God the first fruits of our time too. We wake up in the morning, we get dressed, we run off to work, and we don't even give a second thought to prayer or spending some time with God. It takes you 10 to 15 minutes to, 15, 30 minutes to get up earlier and just spend a little bit of time with the Lord. I mean, he gave you your a day, not promised. Every time we wake up every morning, it's the Lord's gift to us to give us another day. And we should give the first fruits of our time to him, either in prayer, in scripture, just to spend some quiet time and to focus on him and worship him, and also invest our gifts and our abilities. There's so many things that people can do: sing in the church, care for the children in the church. There's so many abilities out there that you can also give. It's not just about money. And so when we take those two things, the Old Testament and the New Testament, the bottom line is the Israelites were the ones who were under the law. So after Jesus came, Jesus fulfilled the law, and we were not under the same bondage of the law. He did so that no one could use the law to advance themselves just because they were obeying the rules or paying their tithes so that they could get into heaven. I'm sure you've heard the scripture, so that no one can boast, because it's not about us, it's about what he came to do for us. And so they couldn't use money or obedience or whatever they were doing, works is what I'm going to call it. No one could do more works than another and then say, well, I'm better than you because I fed the poor, or I gave to the poor, I fed the hungry, stuff like that. So when God came, he abolished the laws, and we were given, he gave us, he came so that we wouldn't be under the law. And You couldn't earn your way into heaven anymore by following the laws. You had to humble yourself and have faith and trust in God and give him more, not just money, but of us, in a way that we should, you know, show our worship, our love, our thankfulness, our just simply honoring him for his goodness, his beauty, and his love. And we should want to give to advance his kingdom. And, you know, we're not under the law of the requirement. And so that means that, you know, we're not pinned to the wall, and God doesn't say, okay, I need 10% of your, you know, income, whether you think it's gross or net. We're not under that law anymore, but we should give to God because we love him, because we want to, you know, show our worship to giving, because we want to help his people. We are his hands and feet, and we want to advance his kingdom. We want to support our church. But we have no fear of being cursed, or it's not a requirement. And God has redeemed us, and we are no longer cursed if we don't tithe or give 10%. But remember that when you do tithe, when you do give to the church or whatever organization that you give to, make sure that it's going towards the kingdom of God. Make sure that the church is doing missions. Make sure that they're spreading the word of God, that they are being his hands and feet. Remember that God said that, you know, his word would have to be spread to the four corners of the earth before he came. Matthew 24:14 states, "And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come." So before Jesus comes, we know that he has said that everyone will hear the word of God. And so, you know, that's very important for us to know and understand. We have to make sure that the church is a place where he can work through the individuals to spread his word, and that we shouldn't give to organizations or churches or individuals that are not working towards that advancement of God's word, because that's what we want. We want to make sure that everybody knows of, you know, the fact that we're not cursed, that when Jesus Christ came, he came to fulfill the law, which means we live under his grace every single day. He came to set us free, and if he says we are free indeed. And so we need to make sure that we know that. And you know, I have seen so many organizations take money and just, I don't see it going towards mission. I don't see it going towards advancing God's word. And so that's definitely something that, you know, you have to think about. And lastly, I'm just going to tell you all about Luke chapter 21, verse 3. "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all the others." And that was talking about the widow who put in a penny. And everybody was criticizing her, like, "Oh, she just put in a penny, you know, wow." But it was everything she had. She gave 100%, not 10%. She gave 100% of her income, because that is all she had. And so, you know, just keep that in mind. You cannot outgive God. And whatever you give to him, he's going to use and multiply. And I promise you one thing, God doesn't need your money, but you should give it to him because you love him and you worship him and you want to see the advancement of his kingdom, his word. And those are the reasons that you should give. But don't ever nickel and dime God. And I feel like I was guilty of that. You know, okay, well, let me see. What is 10%? You know, when you can give more, give more. God knows our situations, like I said at the beginning. And don't always do it just for a tax deduction. Find ways to help the poor, to, you know, feed the hungry, don't always look at it as a tax write-off. And I think last year when I thought about tithing, that was one of the things that I wanted to make sure that I didn't do, that I wanted to make sure that my heart was in the right place. And so I was like, okay, I want to do this, but I don't want there to be perk for me, because I want my heart to be in the right place. I want to do because I want to do, not because I have to, I can write it off as a tax deduction. So anyway, I hope that this was helpful to you and kind of help give you clarity on tithing. And Jesus came and he fulfilled it all. He gave us salvation. He redeemed us from the law. He wants our humility. He wants us to humble ourselves before him. He wants us to give him our time, and he wants us to worship him and love him and spread his word and let everybody know you're free. You don't have to live in bondage, and you definitely don't have to live in bondage with tithing. But please consider, when you think about giving, where you give, and how it's going to help God's kingdom. And I think those are the things that I'm going to be looking at coming this coming year. So anyway, let's close with prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much, Lord, for all the blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Thank you for all that you are in our lives, Lord, and thank you that you sent Jesus to come and fulfill the law, Lord, and that we are no longer under any requirements or curses or bondages, Lord. You have set us free, and we are free indeed. And we thank you, Lord, that you don't require anything of us, but we thank you that we want to do for you. We want to be your hands and feet, and we want to advance your kingdom in any way possible, Lord. So please open our eyes to our church. Please open our eyes to organizations. Please help us and direct us to give to the places where your kingdom and your word will be advanced. We thank you again for all that you have given to us. You have blessed us so abundantly, Lord. You give so much to us, and it's true. We could never outgive everything that you have given to us. When you gave us Jesus, that's just it. We can't ever pay you back for that. And I'm thankful that we don't have to. Thank you that you give us the freedom. And I just pray that we all search our hearts, Lord. We search our hearts and we give back what the little that we can back to you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen, y'all. Have an amazing, blessed Sunday, and I'll catch you next Sunday. Bye.